My wife and I, God bless them today. We were, and it's really something. We were at several house eating lunch, and quite a big commotion going on there. Couldn't figure out what it was. And one of the waitresses we know sort of well, I guess we're there so often that we're on a first name basis with most of them. But anyway, we found out what the commotion was about. Senator Warner was there. And he came around and shook everybody's hand, and that's why I'm holding this one tonight. I ain't gonna wash it for the rest of the night. But anyway, when he finally went on back in the room where they were at, Patrick said, "I wasn't impressed with you." I was going to ask him, "When is my check coming?" But my wife said, "Don't you say nothing. You just be quiet, let it go on." But anyway.
You were talking about that, and I was at Dairy Queen today, and I was waiting on someone else. And a young man pulled in, and Linda Tosh and I were sitting there talking. And he pulled in, and he was on this sporty-looking little car, a young guy. And he backs up into this parking place. Well, I already knew it had a DAV sign. It was reserved for veterans there. And I'm like, ready to go off on him because he backed into this veterans-only parking space. And he backs up, and he puts a little shade up in the window and everything. He gets bopping out. He gets ready to go in. He looks back. And he got back in his car, pulled the shade out, pulled his car out from that parking space and pulled it on along to the side of where we were at. And we thanked him for doing it. And he says, "My stepdad's a veteran." He said, "There's no way I'd stay in that parking spot." But he got back in and when he saw the sign and pulled out. It was a nice young man.
It makes you feel good.
Yeah, it did. But
that lets you know that all folks are not like some of them.
Yeah.
Amen.
Well, what was ironic about the whole event there, all of our dignitaries, the sheriff, whom I like very much because I think he's a Christian man.
He's a good Christian man, I know.
And then our city sheriff was there, and then, of course, our delegates, some of our delegates, and the board of trustees, and blah, blah, blah. It was a big event. And our little waitress came back and she said, "Is it bad of me that I didn't even know who our people are?" And I said, "Oh, he ain't done that for me either, so don't worry about it."
Well, we are encouraged to pray for people that are in authority, and we can pray. Amen. Turn with me tonight to the book of Habakkuk. Not Tubacker, but Habakkuk, okay? There's only three chapters in this little book, and I want to spend the next three Wednesdays just looking at this book, and it's quite unusual. And there are some things in here that really is important as far as our attitude. You know, about everybody you meet today has got an attitude. It can be a good one, it can be mediocre, it can be bad, but we're living in an attitude world, to say the least. You know what? We can go out with a good attitude, and if we allow it, we'll get a bad one real quick. Because there's enough things out there to really change your outlook. And the book of Habakkuk has a lot in common with us today, because the circumstances that prevailed during his time are similar to the ones that we are living in. So I want us to have a word of prayer here, and then we'll read the scripture and have a word of prayer, and then we'll look at this, okay? Verse 1 of chapter 1. The burden which Habakkuk the prophet did see. Now the word burden there means the thing that I saw. The burden is referring to what he saw. And he said this, O Lord, how long shall I cry and thou wilt not hear? I even cry out to thee of violence and thou wilt not save or deliver. Why dost thou show me iniquity and cause me to behold grievance? For spoiling and violence are before me, and there are that raise up strife and contention. There are those who raise in strife and contention. Therefore the law is slacked, and judgment does never go forth. For the wicked doth compass about the righteous, therefore wrong judgment proceedeth. Behold ye among the heathen, and regard and wonder marvelously. Now this is the voice of God in response to Habakkuk. And wonder marvelously, for I will work a work in your days which ye will not believe, though it be told you. For lo, I raise up the Chaldeans, that's the Babylonians, that bitter and hasty nation which shall march through the breadth of the land to possess the dwelling places that are not theirs. They are terrible and dreadful, their judgment and their dignity shall proceed of themselves. They're all about themselves. They're crazy. Their horses also are swifter than the leopards, and are more fierce than the evening wolves. And their horsemen shall spread themselves, and their horsemen shall come from far. They shall fly as an eagle that hasteth to eat. They shall come all for violence. Their faces shall soup up as the east wind, or sup up as the east wind. And they shall gather the captivity as the sand, and they shall scoff at the kings, and the princes shall be a scorn unto them. They shall deride every stronghold, for they shall heap dust and take it. Then shall his mind change, and he shall pass over and offend, imputing this his power unto his God. Art thou not from everlasting? Habakkuk now is taking up the conversation. O Lord my God, my Holy One, we shall not die, O Lord. Thou hast ordained them for judgment. And Almighty God, thou hast established them for correction. Thou art of pure eyes, and to behold evil, and canst not look on iniquity. Wherefore lookest thou upon them that deal treacherously, and holdest thy tongue when the wicked devoureth a man that is more righteous than he, and makest men as the fishes of the sea, as the creeping things that hath no rule over them? They take up all of them with an angle, they catch them in their net, and gather them in their drag. Therefore they rejoice and are glad. Therefore they sacrifice unto their net, and burn incense unto their drag, because by them their portion is fat, and their meat plenteous. Shall they therefore empty their net, and not spare continually to slay the nations? Father, we ask you now to open our minds and our hearts to understand your word, and to understand what you have for us in this hour. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In this first chapter, there are three chapters in this book. The prophet saw something, and he takes up a conversation with God. Jeremiah, by the way, this is one of the minor prophets. There were five major prophets, 23 minor prophets. And these minor prophets were not minor because of their message, but their length. They are called because they're shorter than Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel. They're not minor in what they deal with. So Habakkuk is one of the prophets that prophesied before the Babylonian captivity. The years around 600 BC, 606 BC. It's quite interesting that we go that far back in history and find present day things that are relative. We go back and look in that time period, and there are things that were happening at that period of time that are relative to the hour in which we live. The word Habakkuk means wrestler or embracer, someone that clings, someone that hangs on. And we don't know a lot about Habakkuk. In fact, what we know is what we read here, and that's it. We do know that God called him to write one book in the Bible, gave him a revelation. God did not speak to Habakkuk like he spoke to Jeremiah. Jeremiah receives a message from God, but it's a conversation between Habakkuk and God. Habakkuk initiates a conversation and God answers it. Let me ask you this, would you like to have a conversation with God? You got any questions you'd like to ask him? I guarantee you that every one of us, after we got over the sheer, sheer fear or whatever, even talking to God, the sheer awesomeness of being in his presence, we'd have things that we'd like to ask him. Some of those things would begin with the word why. Why this? Why that? Why is this happening? Why? Some would begin with what? What are you going to do about it? Habakkuk is doing the same thing. So we would have questions that we would ask God. I was thinking the other day, I love Westerns. I like the old Westerns. These new ones, you know, there's so much junk in them. But I like the old Westerns. They started out with a certain thing and continued on, and it always turned out good, right? I was noticing today on TV right before I left the house, Audie Murphy's playing in a film called 20 Rifles for Fort Petticoat. I saw that before. I anything Audie Murphy's in, I like. Anything Clint Eastwood's in, I like. My wife hates Clint Eastwood. Well, she don't hate him, she just don't like his movies. But a sitcom is sort of different. Sitcoms are like Happy Days, you know, that type of thing. And you know, Happy Days would start out, it would start out with a little bit of humor. And that it was funny. I mean, you get all them people together. It starts out with a little humor, and then there's always a plot that creates a little tension, you know what I'm saying? Have you ever noticed how the music changes when it becomes serious, you know? I remember years ago seeing a Christian movie, and it's the title of it was So Many Voices. The voices, there's so many voices out there to be heard, but it's how you hear, where you are when you hear them. For instance, it showed a graveyard in the night, and it was dark, and of course it was playing this music, you know, and it was quite interesting. Right in the middle of that, would you think that somebody's going to reach out a grave and grab somebody? They changed the music. And they started playing Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. You know? And it was totally hilarious. Graveyards weren't even scared. You know? It was the music that created this. So you got a little tension. But at the end of it, you know, what's the guy's name was on Happy Days?
Fonzie.
And who was the other guy?
Richie.
Yeah. And then there was another one in there. What was in there? Potsy. Yeah. They were crazy. And they'd get themselves in a predicament, but then it would always turn out right. You know, that's sort of like people look at life. There's some human life, but then there are times when that same life has a serious tension created in it. But somehow we buy into the idea that everything's going to turn out all right. And it's not right, not that way in Habakkuk. As we look at this, we look at it and we see that it's not going to turn out good. It's not a scenario that's going to be good. And we live in a day when the world is in total darkness about God's plan. People who are not saved, they don't know what lies ahead. They don't care what lies ahead. Many of them think, okay, it may be bad right now, but I think it's going to change. In fact, politicians make a living out of telling us that everything's going to get better. Educators make a living out of telling us that everything is going to be better. But sometimes it don't work out that way. At least not in our minds. So when Habakkuk sees the circumstances that are in his life and what he's living in right now, he is really, really upset. Now, there are three responses when we look at life and look at, and I said the world a while ago, the church and Christians, and I'm not too much worried about the world, because the biggest part of people going to hell anyway. Broad is the way that leads to destruction. Amen? I'm not too much worried about them other than that they need the gospel. And they need to be saved, and we need to tell them the gospel and get it out. But there are people in this world tonight that are alive that you could preach to them 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, and they still gonna die and go to hell because they're hell-bent. I don't know whether you believe that or not, but I do. They're not going to change. But now, when you come to the Christian life, and I was thinking the other day, the kind of Christianity that we are putting forth today is very, very shaky. As I said Sunday, we go through the narrow gate And then we think that gate opens up into a broad avenue that allows us to be whatever we want to be, do whatever we want to do. But the Bible says, straight is the gate, narrow is the way. And Jesus said, I am the way. So what happens when all of this happens around us? And Habakkuk lived in a time, he was part of the tribe of Judah. Judah was a good tribe. There were 10 tribes that was a northern kingdom and 2 tribes that made up the southern kingdom. And the 2 tribes in the south, which Judah was a part of, was supposed to be the ones that were following God. Now, and so Habakkuk's trying to figure out what's going on. During that time, during this time, we just read what's going on. Let's read this again. Verse 2. How long shall I cry, and thou wilt not hear? I believe that Habakkuk was praying and asking God to change things. Now, I hear a lot of people today saying this, that we're going to see a revival in the end time. I don't think so. There are 2 reasons that I don't think so. Number one, I think we have gone beyond as a church and Christian, I think we've gone beyond our day of grace. And number two, I don't think that the church collectively, Christians in general, even want a revival. Because they're satisfied with what's going on in their life. They don't, as long as it goes without a lot of problems, they really don't care. He said, how long am I going to call? How long am I going to keep crying? And I believe that, I would love to believe that we're going to have a great and wonderful return to God revival. I would love to believe that. And I believe this, I want to say this, we cannot quit praying for that. Maybe a few will be revived on the way. But the church is never going to have, in my mind, the impact that it had a few decades ago. Because the brand of Christianity that we're presenting to the world today is not biblical Christianity. It's just not. So we're not going to have, and so Habakkuk said, how long do I have to cry? And you don't hear. Is God deaf? Can he hear? Does he want to hear? It's not that. He can't. Now why? Listen to what he said. Even cry unto thee of violence, and thou wilt not say. Is there violence anywhere in the world today? Is there a nation on the face of the earth that is not facing violence? I just heard yesterday that there is a move by the intelligenzo, I can't remember what state it is, but they are advocating, they're already doing this, and I'll tell you what this is in a minute. They are advocating that autistic people, can you guess what? Be put to death. Do you know, has there ever been a time in the world when we had that kind of situation? I think I remember that Hitler said that if you were not white and if you were not whatever, then you ought to die. That's why 6 million Jews died. We're already killing the unborn. So in order to protect our human race, we're willing to wipe out anybody, because there are people who already believe that there are people who are on this earth that and I include myself with them, that are so ignorant that we don't deserve to live. And that's true, because they feel that way. Now, the state of Oregon has taken children away from an autistic couple. Her IQ was 7-something and his was 6-something, and they said they were not qualified to be parents, and they took their children away from them. And this, the woman who worked for the state, who investigated them, said that's in her opinion, that they were fine. These two people took classes offered by the state on how to raise children, do all these things. They still took them away. Now, ladies and gentlemen, that's violence. That's humanity. Violence, but human violence by other humans. And this is taking place in our country. Now, look what he said. Why dost thou show me iniquity and cause me to behold grievance? Why are you showing me all of this? Why am I seeing all of this? I'll be quite honest with you, I don't even want to watch the news. And this is the freest nation on the earth. We're in the same problem. Habakkuk seeing all this violence. Back in those days, there were people offering their children to the god Moloch. The god Moloch was a metal statue. And he had his arms out like this. And they would heat that metal statue, built a fire inside of it, and they'd heat that metal statue until his arms were cherry red, and they'd take their babies and their kids and lay them in his arms. You say, that would never happen in America. Don't tell me. When a doctor can go into an operating room and say, this is a woman's right, and tear a baby apart, and then there's another group who wants to buy the parts, tell me how moral it is. And we condone it. You say, well, I don't condone it, but, and sure, see, we're the Habakkuk's. We're crying out, why are you allowing this, God? Why is this happening? Notice what he said, and there are that raise up strife and contention. Therefore the law is slacked, and judgment does never go forth, for the wicked does compass about the righteous, therefore wrong judgment proceedeth. I'm going to say this, when you look at, and then I'm saying this in regard to what we've experienced in the last few days in America. When you look at a statue and you say that sends my soul into grief and all of that, and I'm not there, I don't know. And then you look at someone who kills a child or says an autistic person shouldn't live, and there's no difference. Folks, we're living in the same time. Now, how do we respond to that? What do Christians respond? How do Christians respond to this? Well, you see, we've got, the Christians have got themselves in a position, and now everybody is separating themselves from Mr. Trump because he simply said there's wrong on both sides. No, you can't say that. There's only wrong on one side. So what do we try, what do we do? What do Christians do? What we try to do, what we do, the first response is we try to recreate that which was good in the past. Now let me give you. I can remember when I first went in the ministry. You could have a 10-day revival and people would come. Pack the house up. But you won't do that today. It won't happen. You know why? Because people got more important things to do. They got something else they want to do. They're not willing to pay the price. So they won't. We try to go back. We try to recreate. And we're not going to recreate it. It ain't going to happen. We ain't going back. God doesn't go back. He goes forward. Amen? Secondly, when you tell people what they have to do, they get mad. They say, I'm out of here. I didn't sign up for this. I didn't sign up for this. All I need God for is to get me to heaven. That's all I need him for. And if he requires anything else, I'm out of it. It's no more than joining a fraternity or no more than joining a club. Or we can say this, Lord, it don't make no difference how bad it gets. It don't make no difference what goes down. I'm still trusting in you. Now, Habakkuk, I want to say this to you, Habakkuk. Prepare to be amazed. We see the confusion of the prophet in this first chapter here. He's confused by the silence of God. I'm confused at times by the silence of God. Are you? Not because of God, but because of my ability to not understand, my inability not to understand what is happening. See, Habakkuk is saying to God, all of this is happening. Why has it happened? Why are you allowing this to happen? And God's saying, it's happening because of you, not because of me. I'm not making this happen. I'm not taking my kids and laying them in the arms of Moloch. I'm not calling God's name in vain. I'm not denying the Lord. I'm not living like the world. I'm not doing all that. I'm God. I'm still God. I'm just like I was. It's you. It's your sins that have separated us. And that's where America is. He's confused about the silence. He's confused, by the way, by the long-suffering of God. Why don't you do something about this? You ever say that? God, you can stop this. Why don't you do something about it? He's confused by the open sin that's being permitted in that day. And I'll be honest with you, I don't understand. I don't understand how a holy God can sit in heaven and not take issue with people who are as sinful as America is. And you may not agree with that. Let me take it a step further. I don't understand how God can sit in heaven and put up with Christians the way we are. Amen. I just don't understand that. It confuses me. But I need to go a little bit further. While Habakkuk is confused, I want you to look, man, we leave him in verses 1, 2, and 3, and he is totally confused. You're putting all this stuff out there. I'm seeing all this. I'm seeing these people do what they're doing, and I don't understand. I'm confused. I can't take it all in. I don't know what you're doing. Now, God comes into the conversation. And God says, Habakkuk, look here. Behold ye among the heathen and regard. Now, where does he direct his attention to? Who do you refer to now in that verse? Behold ye the heathen and regard, or learn. Look at the nations of the world. Look what's going on in the world and learn a lesson. God is working. God is going to work. Notice what he said. And wonder and marvelously. In other words, it'll take your breath away. And I read this book, I read this verse, I preached from the next phrase, but I never saw what God showed me today. God is working among the world, the nations. And I've always preached this verse that God's going to do a great, marvelous spiritual work in the last days. But I'm here to tell you tonight that I see another option. And I see the real thing. So he says to Habakkuk, who is looking at all these things that are confusing him, and he can't get it bearing, and he keeps asking God, and God don't say anything. He said, behold, I will do a work in your days which you will not believe, though it be told you. God's getting ready to do something. How do I know? Two reasons. Number one, the condition in the church and the condition in the world. Do you realize this, that there is no mention of the United States of America in prophecy? And I read in the book of Proverbs that governments don't go on forever. And we got some enemies in like we've never had before. See, we fought the Germans, and we fought the Japanese, and we fought other people over that. But you know what I think it's going to take to get America straightened out? And most of all, and I don't know, no, let me rephrase that. You know what God's going to do to America? It's time for God. God's going to judge America. God's going to judge America. My time's about out, but let me tell you, did you know this? God sent the Babylonians down, and they took, by the way, Habakkuk received his revelation right before the 70-year captivity of when the Babylonians came in and destroyed the city of Jerusalem, killed thousands upon thousands of people. And if any nation on the face of the earth ever deserved the judgment of God, and I say this, and I love America from the bottom of my feet to the top of my head, America does. See, we've, and there's some reasons, because of the extended grace of God. God's been better to America. The only other nation that's been blessed more than America is Israel. But God blessed America because America was good. But America has lost her goodness. America was good because of her faith in God, her trust in Christ. And that's when the churches were the strongest in the world. But that has changed. We got a madman in North Korea that can release. And it wouldn't surprise me. You say, is God going to use him to correct? I don't know. But the Bible tells us that God sent the Babylonians down there. Let me show you something. Do you realize how sinful that North Korea is? They look at their leader as God. Why in the world would God leave take somebody who was worse than we are to correct us? That's exactly what he did here in the Bible. He took the Babylonians who hated God, who were 100 times worse than sinning worse than Judah was sinning. And the people were saying, well, surely they're not, God wouldn't do that. Yes, God will. God will. So what I'm saying tonight is, I'm raising this question. Is America beyond revival? I think so. They're not beyond revival because God can't. I believe America's beyond revival because we won't. God can. But listen, God's not going to force himself on anybody. So national judgment came upon Judah. That's when Daniel and his 3 friends wound up down in Babylon. That's when Nebuchadnezzar came up just a little bit after this, and the fires were so hot in that city of Jerusalem that the gold melted, the gold and silver melted. No, I'm wrong. I'm getting that. The 70 year when Titus came and destroyed the city. But the people died. People were cut off, and there's terrible suffering that came. And I believe this, that we're heading for. Now listen to what Habakkuk says, and let me read this. Look at verse number 12. When God told Habakkuk, this is what's going to happen. I'm going to come among you and judge you with a nation that's 10 times worse than you are. And Habakkuk thought, oh my God, how can you do that? Look at verse 12. He said, art thou not from everlasting, O Lord my God, mine Holy One? We shall not die. Surely you're not going to do that. O Lord, thou hast ordained them for judgment, and Almighty God, thou hast established them for correction. He's saying, these people are too sinful. These people are worse than we are. Look at verse 13. Thou art of purer eyes than to behold evil and cannot look on iniquity. How in the world can you use them to correct us? And he points out how bad they were. They were like people fishing, and they were gathering people in the net, and they were dragging them in. And if you study about the Babylonians and how they conquered people and what they did, they were awful. And he said, I'm confused about this. There's coming a judgment day. And that judgment day is going to happen because of people's unbelief, because of their unpreparedness. People are not prepared today. We're too earthbound. We're too world connected. We're in danger. I'll be quite honest with you. I'm glad that you got North Korea back then, but I'm not surprised that there's a threat. We have a twofold threat. One of them is Iran, and one of them is North Korea. And I hear people saying, they'll just blow him off of the earth. What good is that to the millions of people who are going to die? What good is that to our country if it's going to devastate our country? Who knows where they're going to head if they do? And I'm not here standing here saying that it's going to happen in your lifetime or my lifetime, but I'm going to tell you what. America is going to pay for her sins. And I love America. I would to God it wouldn't be true. Somebody said, well, you could be wrong. I could, and I hope I am. But God never let other nations sin and get by with it. And he's put there's too much of the grace of God that has been denied, and people have looked in the face of God and thumbed their nose at him and said, I'll do whatever I want to do. And I dare you to do anything with it. It'll happen. It'll happen. God, there ain't no telling who he is. He may use a drunk on the highway. You say, surely no. When God uses his judgment. By the way, did you know this? The Bible says that God's judgment is a strange work. He don't like to judge his mind. He don't like to correct people. When you had children, did you like to correct them? You had to. But you didn't enjoy it because you was hurting your flesh and blood. God don't enjoy correcting us either. But he has to because we're his. We belong to him. So what do we do tonight? Let me tell you this. Pray. Read the rest of this book in chapter 2. It's quite interesting what Habakkuk does. It's quite interesting what he does and how he himself prepares himself. Now the only way, and I'm saying this, the only way that you can prepare yourself is to make sure that you're not in the crowd that's thumbing their nose at God. Amen? Make sure that people that are faithful to God, that serve God, live for God, that's the only way you prepare yourself. You know, the sad thing about it is when God begins to judge, if you're around people who are not living for God, you know, when I was a kid growing up, my brother and I slept together. And my daddy would have an issue with him, and he'd near kill me too. And whipping him, he'd whip me, because he had a switch that reached from here to the wall. And he is just frailing. And I'm gonna tell you what, you get around people that ain't living for God, when God gets ready to correct them, he may get you too. Amen?
Amen.
Better stay straight before the Lord. Amen? Father in heaven, thank you tonight for the word of God. And I pray that you will help our nation. Oh God, we would pray for a revival. I would pray that Christians would get serious about the Lord. But I don't know what you'll have to do in America to get people serious. I've seen it happen over and over in my ministry. When a crisis comes in America, people flock to the church. But when everything is going good, they have no time for the church. So Lord, if you have to send another catastrophe, that's in your will and your power to do so. I have not the authority, nor do I want to tell you what to do. I just pray that you keep my heart straight, keep my heart steady, keep my life clean and before you, honest, ready to go and meet the Lord. Thank you for your love. Thank you for this time together. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Sign the prayer letter.